The notion that Kane himself is some sort of version of myself, I really fail to recognize.
Is it true that when Citizen Kane was being made, that people actually tried to stop it being made? And is it true that Randolph Hearst, the newspaper tycoon, took it as being an attack on himself and tried to stop it when it was made being shown?
To the first part of your question, there was indeed a very definite effort to stop the film during shooting by those elements in the studio who were attempting to seize power, because in those days, studio politics, particularly RKO and indeed many of the big studios in Hollywood, were very much like Central American republics. And there were revolutions and counter-revolutions and every sort of palace intrigue.
Welcome, guys, to another video that is a little bit more of a solemn video compared to my previous reviews. In this case, I wanted to talk about a film that has been talked about a lot since its release in 1941, but in this case, I wanted to discuss the often not talked about controversy involving the film's pre-release and release, essentially a thing called Hearst versus Welles. And on that note, this is called In Defense of Citizen Kane. A title like In Defense of Citizen Kane could be considered a clickbaity title. I mean, what is there to defend? It's considered one of the greatest films ever made. It has topped the American Film Institute's greatest films ever made list consistently, and it has been on the National Film Registry since 1989 as one of the most culturally significant films of American history. But I wanted to talk about the elements that were often not mentioned in documentaries of the film. The documentary The Battle Over Citizen Kane does discuss this, but I wanted to discuss things that are not mentioned too often. You can find sources on Wikipedia, you can find them on The Guardian, you can find them on Welles.net. There's some very good sources about the difficulties that Orson Welles had trying to get the film released because a man named William Randolph Hearst did not like the film.
Mr. Hearst was quite a bit like Kane, although Kane isn't really founded on Hearst. In particular, there are many people sat for it, so to speak. But he was like Kane in that he wouldn't have stooped to such a thing. But he had many hatchet men, editors and representatives of this great network of newspapers all over the country.
So going back, who exactly was William Randolph Hearst? William Randolph Hearst was considered, in many ways, he was the equivalent of a Rupert Murdoch, or an equivalent of Donald Trump. Somebody with a lot of influence who made a lot of money using sensationalism to their advantage. They had a huge media influence, they sold papers, throwing out headlines in the most exploitive fashions to make money. Hearst had a lot of money. He was considered one of the richest men at the time. So how does this relate to Citizen Kane? Citizen Kane was a film that when Orson Welles was pretty much given the keys by RKO Studios, Radio Keefe Orpheum Studios in the 1940s, he was given the option of making any film he could make.
I mean, everybody knows that you had the most astonishing contract that Hollywood has ever provided.
Yes.
Ever.
Not financially speaking, in terms of authority and rights. Financially, it wasn't extraordinary in any way at all. It was extraordinary in the control it gave me over my own material.
You had total control.
Total control, so much so that the rushes, which I perhaps should explain are the pieces of film that are shown at the end of the day's work, as I'm sure you understand, and are always checked by everybody in the studio, department heads and the bankers and distributors and everything, long before there's a rough cut. According to the terms of my contract, the rushes couldn't be seen by anyone. And indeed, the film couldn't be seen until it was ready for release.
He was fresh off the massive success of H.G. Wells' The War of the Worlds radio broadcast in October 1938. George Safer, the studio head of RKO, decided this guy can pretty much do anything. He can garner huge, massive attention. So he wanted to give this guy a chance to direct his own film. Going from the Irish stage to Broadway to radio, seems like film was the next big thing. Orson Welles was a huge fan of the director John Ford, and he loved German expressionism. These were his main sources for Citizen Kane. He surprisingly decided to come up with the concept of a fake biopic, based off someone who was real, or in this case, suggested, and he came up with the options of either Howard Hughes or William Randolph Hearst. He later pointed out that Howard Hughes had a life that was so unbelievable, so over the top, that nobody would ever believe any movie that was based off him. Something he alluded to in the 1973 mockumentary F for Fake, which he would make many years later. So he decided to go with a Hearst film. He makes the film, does a lot of innovative stuff with it that a lot of people have already talked about, and here's where it gets interesting. I'm going to talk about the film's many innovations and all the things that make it incredible, but I'm going to give you 10 things that are amazing about Citizen Kane. It is random enough, hopefully it'll get you to watch this movie if you haven't. Number 10, what makes a man like Charles Foster Kane tick? Everything that's great about him, everything that's terrible about him, and everything in between. There weren't very many movies before Citizen Kane that were about that. So come 1941, the film was scheduled to be released at RKO's flagship theater, the famous Radio City Music Hall, on February 14th. But by early January 1941, Welles was not quite finished, so a rough cut was selected for a few theaters on January 3rd, 1941. One of the many members of the press was a woman named Hedda Hopper. She was uninvited, so she found a way to sneak into the screening. Even though many of the other critics had found the film to be quite good and gave it good advanced reviews, Hopper wrote negatively about it. Hopper was somewhat of a Hearst loyalist and called it a vicious and irresponsible attack on a great man. Even though Citizen Kane is quite obviously a satire and makes absolutely no mention of Hearst by name, it was very obvious at the time who this film was making fun of.
The big effort to overthrow the then head of the studio, who was taken to be out of his mind because he'd given me this contract, which made the making of these films possible, and stopping me or proving my incompetence would have won their case. Mr. Hearst was quite a bit like Kane, although Kane isn't really founded on Hearst. In particular, there are many people sat for it, so to speak. But he was like Kane in that he wouldn't have stooped to such a thing. But he had many hatchet men, editors and representatives of this great network of newspapers all over the country. And to get in good with the chief, there was a good deal of very strong effort.
Hopper went on, calling the writing corny and saying that Greg Toland's famous cinematography was old-fashioned. A lot of movies are meant to be fun and have silly moments. Calling it corny is like a blanket statement that doesn't really hold much water. It only holds water to somebody who's trying to put down the film and to negate the film in a fairly generic perspective. Number 9. Greg Toland was an incredible cinematographer. He'd worked with John Ford. Typically, black and white films had soft backgrounds and shallow depths of field. He worked in creating deep focus. You'll see people running up to the camera in sharp focus. That's Greg Toland. That's why Orson Welles appreciated Greg Toland so much that he shared a title card with him at the end of the film. This eventually led to the magazine Friday drawing up an article creating a point-by-point comparison between Kane and Hearst, and how Citizen Kane was a fairly accurate portrayal of Hearst's life. It was this article that sent William Randolph Hearst in a tirade. He was piping hot mad. The man would not rest until Citizen Kane was burned to the ground. He would not rest until Orson Welles was destroyed as a person. And this is where the scary stuff happens, and why this film had to be defended. Another film columnist and Hearst employee was a woman named Luella Parsons, who was humiliated by Citizen Kane because it made her boss look bad. And this caused her to leap up and take action. She was going to defend her boss from the young man who was trying to tear him down. A young man who had no standing next to the great Hearst. Hearst thought that Luella Parsons was sleeping on the job because he heard it from the Friday article and from Hopper, and not specifically from her. The situation between Hearst and Parsons became tense, and it compelled her to start attacking Welles in the film at all costs. She demanded a private screening of the film, just for her, and threatened studio head George Schaefer on Hearst's behalf. She said, "I'm going to sue you unless I see this film on my own so I can review it." She also posed a huge threat toward anyone in Hollywood who was trying to prevent her from doing so. So eventually, on January 10th, 1941, Parsons and two lawyers working for Hearst were given a private screening of Citizen Kane. The sound recordist to Welles, James G. Stewart, was present during the screening and had stated that she'd walked out of the film. So now the drama is getting really intense. Parsons then ring-rings Schaefer and threatens RKO Studios with a lawsuit if they released Kane. Additionally, she contacts the management of Radio City Music Hall and demands that they not screen it as well.
I had no hope of being elected.
Not only was Citizen Kane in the crosshairs, Hearst also started attacking RKO's film Kitty Foyle. He eventually lifted the ban on all other RKO films except Kane. Citizen Kane became public enemy number one. One of the reasons why Citizen Kane does survive today is largely in part to studio head George Schaefer. He was there when Orson was starting out in the movie business, and he was going to keep fighting for Orson till the end. So Schaefer was starting to get sick of this Parsons person. She started to call other studio heads and made more threats on behalf of Hearst. Orson himself started to realize that his private life was being used against him. Right when this film was just about to hit theaters, William Randolph Hearst was inventing the concept of public shaming, or trial by media, or in today's world, cancel culture. This was a thing that he loved to do when he wanted to get his way. At the time, Orson was in a romance with actress Dolores Del Rio, who would eventually star in his third film and directorial effort, Journey into Fear. She was married at the time, and he wanted the affair to be kept secret until her divorce was finalized. And as this was going on, Hearst was preparing an injunction, saying the film was a case of libel and invasion of privacy. Yeah, but Welles' lawyer and manager, a man named Arnold Weisberger, felt that the injunction wouldn't go very far, because it required testimony. But he did know one thing. This is not a tempest in a teapot. It will not calm down, and the forces opposed to us are constantly at work, Weisberger would later say. Weisberger, at his most damning and honest, though, would say, Hearst may decide to use all his legal machinery to harass RKO. The Hollywood Reporter ran a front-page story on the 13th of January, where Hearst was about to attack Hollywood's practice of hiring refugees and immigrants for jobs that could be done by Americans. Number 8. Welles tried to get a diverse cast. You'll see African Americans in the film. They usually are singing, they usually are playing instruments, some kind of musical element. That was the best he could do in 1940 conventions. Hollywood was not really in the business of hiring anybody that wasn't white, but Welles did his best to try to get as many African Americans and later multiple people of different cultures into his films. This was no doubt an attack on the notion that Hollywood was hiring directors like Billy Wilder, Josef von Sternberg, and Fritz Lang to do American films. They were German filmmakers, some of Welles' favorite German expressionists, and that Hearst believed that Americans could be doing those films instead. Many of these immigrants had fled Europe after the rise of fascism in both Germany and Italy and wanted to live in the United States and make films. One of the weirdest things that happened was that Schaefer was approached by Nicholas Schenck, head of MGM's parent company, with an offer on the very behalf of Louis B. Mayer to destroy all prints of Citizen Kane, burn the negative at a cost of $805,000. RKO's legal team had reassured Schaefer that by January 21st, Kane would be released as scheduled, and their largest promotional campaigns in the studio's history would ensure this. Citizen Kane had enraged Hearst so much that no advertising, reviewing, or mentioning of it would be ever in his papers. His journalists were going to put a libel suit on Welles if there was any other cases of Hearst being mentioned by Welles. The Motion Picture Herald had now reported that Hearst was intending to sue RKO. Time magazine said the objection of Mr. Hearst, who founded a publishing empire on sensationalism, is ironic. For to most of the several hundred people who have seen the film at private screenings, Citizen Kane is the most sensational product of the U.S. movie industry. So even as the film was just about to be released, the papers were saying, the ones that were not Hearst papers, that the film was excellent. Anyone who tried to show Citizen Kane would be under the intense scrutiny and public shaming of William Randolph Hearst's empire. Unfortunately, the backers were not too impressed with the numbers and thought Citizen Kane could have done far better. Hearst's biographer David Nassau did point out that Hearst's actions were not only the reason Kane failed, but he did point out Citizen Kane's innovations and Welles' ability with his talent to create something very new and fresh. Number 7, the makeup, the special effects, the sets, the editing. All these are things that Welles came to really admire, but they taught Hollywood all the things that you could do with a Hollywood movie that hadn't really been attempted before.
I thought you could do anything with a camera that the eye could do or the imagination could do. And if you come up from the bottom in the film business, you're taught all the things that the cameraman doesn't want to attempt for fear he will be criticized for having failed.
Yes.
And in this case, I had a cameraman who didn't care if he was criticized if he failed, and I didn't know that there were things you couldn't do. So anything I could think up in my dreams, I attempted to photograph.
You got away with enormous technical advances, didn't you?
Simply by not knowing that they were impossible, or theoretically impossible.
Yeah.
And of course, again, I had a great advantage, not only in the real genius of my cameraman, but in the fact that he, like all great men, I think, who are masters of a craft.
Hopefully you'll come to like it more, as I did as a teenager. He liked the narrative style, the non-linear storytelling, and the dark message the film said that success would ultimately be futile. Here comes one of the creepiest stories. A police detective would later approach Orson Welles and tell him not to go back to his hotel, citing that they found a 14-year-old girl hiding in his hotel room closet. It turned out two photographers were waiting for him in order to frame him for having a supposed affair with a 14-year-old girl. Orson believed the detective and did not return back to his hotel room. It turned out, as creepy as this was, Hearst did not orchestrate this, but a rogue Hearst employee was trying to get a big scoop and planned this without his knowledge. However, a number of biographers do believe that Hearst did know about the whole thing. But can you imagine that? You show up at your room to find somebody that's not supposed to be there, and for other people to jump in on you and take your damn picture, to make it look like something else is going on. That is gotta be one of the creepiest things of all time.
An effort to frame me on a criminal charge, which a policeman was good enough to tell me about, is sensational and silly. And dangerous and gangsterish is that.
Number 6, this little editing treasure. Charles Foster Kane screams, "I'm Charles Foster Kane! I'm gonna send you to Sing Sing!" And then when his wife and his political rival shut this door, "Sing Sing!" Then honk honk. You'll love the fact that it goes from barking to honking. At some point, Orson Welles and William Randolph Hearst did meet again in an elevator at the Fairmont Hotel. At which point Orson did invite Hearst to see the film when it came out. Supposedly Hearst said nothing, but Orson kept trying to find some way to get Hearst to at least, you know, back off. Hearst didn't reply at all, but did later say in the newspaper, "A few years later, in 1945, when the dust settled and had completed two other films under his Mercury production, The Magnificent Ambersons in 1942 and Journey into Fear in 1943, Hearst realized that such hysterical barking by the trained seals would attract too much attention to the picture, but to this day, the name of Orson Welles is on the official son-of-a-bitch list of every Hearst newspaper." Even years later, he was still a son-of-a-bitch to Hearst. In spite of all of Hearst's attempts to destroy Citizen Kane and its memory, several newspapers included references to Citizen Kane connected to Hearst. For example, "Son of Citizen Kane dies" for the obituary of Hearst's son, William Randolph Hearst, and evil Spencer Tracy. Number 5, one of the few flaws of this film, unless you're trying to look for flaws, is this giant cockatoo that screeches in front of the camera. It was added to the shot superimposed, so it wasn't really in front of the coastline. But Welles added it in because he was afraid people were starting to fall asleep at this time. And you can see through the eye of the parrot, which is a little weird, but obviously they did it at the last minute. That was one of the few things that Welles snuck in there that maybe he didn't have to do, but it's actually quite hilarious too. Watch the film, people are talking very calmly, and then suddenly, rah! I think the thing that bothered Hearst the most was that, in spite of him owning 26 newspapers, 16 magazines, and 11 radio stations, every other competitor was still connecting Citizen Kane to him. In 2012, Hearst did finally lose the battle. Not because he was dead in 2012, he had been long dead before that, but Citizen Kane was screened at his equivalent of Xanadu. Number 4, symbolism. There's a lot of symbolism in Citizen Kane. It's one of the hallmarks of Welles' filmography. Now, it's not like Welles invented symbolism, symbology, or any kind of iconography. No. One of my favorites is pointed out by Peter Bogdanovich and Roger Ebert, is a shot when Welles and his best friend, Jed Leland, played by the great Joseph Cotten, walk towards the editor's office of the Enquirer. Jed stops because he realizes that a pole has separated his best friend and him, so he walks around the pole because he doesn't want to jinx their friendship. I'm waiting for that Orson Welles versus William Randolph Hearst movie. I think that sounds like another great movie. And a real biopic, not in this case a fake biopic, but a real biopic. The thing that is very interesting that should be discussed more is the Hearst versus Welles battle. They do discuss it in the film RKO 281, starring Liev Schreiber and James Cromwell. But I think there should be a little bit more discussion in terms of what was going on in the media at the time, all the papers and all the people working for RKO to preserve Citizen Kane. Because if it weren't for them, there would be no greatest film ever made. It might be Casablanca or The Godfather, or The Shawshank Redemption, according to IMDb. Number 3. Orson Welles used a back brace to create the effect that he was older. He used a back brace so that he couldn't move his legs or bend his back as well as he could. Remember, Orson was about 26 years old when he made this film, so he wanted to not think about it and just be old. It would be the equivalent of making a film about George W. Bush, not mentioning Bush by name. We'll call the film President Shrub and star Will Ferrell. It would be something like that. And it would be a satire. Something like that. Number 2. Not to give too much of anything away, but the sled that you see in this movie that has some kind of meaning, I don't know what is the meaning. Basically, it's not really about the sled, if people want to make an argument about this, and I'm looking at you, Peter Griffin. The sled is a symbol of Kane's childhood, going back to a simpler time, before he became rich. That's what Kane wants, that's what he desires above all things. He wished he could start his life all over again. And finally, number 1, you can read my essay that I wrote as a teenager on Citizen Kane. It's called All Eyes on Citizen Kane, and it's one of my favorite things I've ever written. It's a bit long, it's overwrought, but what can you do when you're a teenager and you're trying to impress everybody? However, it's very, very concise and very, very thought out. A little scary that I thought about that movie way too much and way too often. But it is available at the link below. Check it out. Please subscribe to Flicker Theater. Cheers.
Every list of great films, of course, many of them lead with Citizen Kane and say it's the finest film made. Do you agree?
No, certainly not. That's my next one is, though. That's the
Magnificent Ambersons.
No, not the one after that. The one I'm preparing at this moment.
Oh, the next one.
That's going to make history.
Could you give us the title of that?
I haven't decided what it is yet.
Oh. I see.